Welcome back, everybody, to day two of the Hearthstone Grand Prix here at DreamHack Winter 2015. It's time to go into what is the second phase of our Swiss for rounds 8 and 9, followed by the round of 16, ultimately find out who will be our first premier event champion for the Hearthstone World Championships of 2016. My name is Ferdinand. I'm joined once again at the desk by Marcin Nims Filipovic, as well as Jakub Loszar-Szyguski, two great casters from Poland. And one American cast who can't pronounce Polish last names correctly.
It was great as well.
Yeah, I mean, I'll work on it. I feel like I've said your name a lot of times. I can say Mars's name correctly.
Yeah, it's absolutely correct when you pronounce it as an English person.
Almost. What? Okay, you have way too many consonants in your name. You have like two vowels.
Yeah,
and
I know,
like seven consonants with Y's and Z's.
Usually when I check into a hotel, I'm just like, I'll just give you my ID. It's way easier.
Sure.
So I don't have to. Okay. Know, you know.
You can enough. Use the trick from Army of Darkness. Whenever you try to pronounce his last name, cough at the same time.
Sorry, I got kind of choked up there. You know, just thinking about Lothar. Well, guys, we've been having a lot of fun here at the event at DreamHack. Yesterday, we started off with 200 competitors. Today, we're down to, well, just under about 60 with remaining players who are eligible to be able to go through. Some people are here competing just to play through for the sake of potentially advancing to the round of 16, because that's where the cutoff is for our Swiss event. Why don't we go ahead and talk about a little bit what we saw yesterday as we recap some of the things that are happening in this event, Nimsh?
Well, we've seen a lot of good stuff. We've seen the top players actually having perfect scores almost. At the end of the day, we've seen Hoi, JJ, Purple, and Xiaoyu having a great score. We've seen Purple bringing the Malagos Warlock with Brown Bronzebeard.
Yeah.
So some League of Explorers are being played. We've also seen Reno Jackson. So a lot of interesting techs. We also talked about Dreadsteeds. Unfortunately, we haven't seen them on stream. But
I think they're eliminated.
They're probably eliminated, but people still brought
Dreadsteeds. But Dreadsteeds will live forever.
The 20 Dreadsteeds are eliminated right now.
Well, I remember people talking about they really want to see Dreadsteed continue to be a little bit more fleshed out, but just by the varied styles, right? I think one deck that's surprising yet again is this Maligos Warlock. Last DreamHack Swiss, it was the same exact story.
Yeah,
exactly. Malilock was something that people were like, yeah, I heard of it. It's okay, but it's probably not that good. And Purple, before yesterday, playing Super JJ, he was 17-0 with it. He won 17 games, sweeping many series, and he finally dropped his first game to Super JJ, and he's pretty pissed. So, you know, I shouldn't have lost that game. It's a 95% win rate.
Yeah, it's actually amazing. And people still don't realize how Bran works. When you see Bran when heal for 16,
yeah,
like also Bran when Twilight Drake.
Yeah, it's like a 4-14, and you're like, wow, it's pretty good.
It's so crazy. Six damage to face with Corruptor.
Yeah, the 6 damage to the face with Corruptor was an amazing finisher. And not everyone was like instantly catching on the lethal there. It was like, well, you can kill the low tap this turn, so you can just manage board control. It's pretty sick. Oh, you can just kill him. Okay, yeah. That's even better.
Yeah, right? And he said he almost missed that too. So fun stuff all around. We recognize that not everyone was able to tune in because we did start on Thursday. Today is Friday, only day two of the events. Let's go ahead and walk through some of the quick facts about how this event will go. We have $40,000 on the line here for the Swiss event, and we have 200 competitors that plays in Swiss, meaning that every single round you face off another opponent with a similar score as you.
Yes.
And now you continue to go through rounds 8 and 9 today. We're going to finish out the round of 16, and tomorrow we have the playoffs for the top 8 onwards. 40K, bring your own device, last hero standing best of 5.
It's a really good format. I was talking to the players and they're happy that we move away from Conquest to something different, and we have the decks that are actually having clean sweep. For example, Ahoy had a lot of success with his Paladin deck, having a 14-0 score at some point even.
Yeah. There's some decks that are very powerful, but I think the story of the tournament for most of these guys is that it's one deck per player that's outperforming everyone else based on their strategy and their comfort level. Hoi is a player that he often plays like mid-range Paladin. Now he's playing Secrets Paladin. He's very comfortable with that class. Purple, he created that deck, and he gave it to his teammate Proto, also on Gamer's Origin, who also had an undefeated score. I think he said his record was 14 wins straight before he finally dropped his first game and ultimately a series. So it's very interesting to see that different styles and different decks is working for these players. You know, some people were like Dark Wanderer says his Shaman deck performed very well yesterday. Even though he lost his matches, every time he played Shaman, he won.
Absolutely.
So look at that.
And it's not a double elimination as well. That's also very important for those guys because a lot of 7-2s will actually make it. In fact, I feel only one 7-2 will not make it at the top 16.
Hmm. Yeah, and it's pretty sick that we might have one undefeated player in Swiss, because usually how Swiss works with mathematically should be one person that is undefeated, but sometimes there are situations when there might be two players with a similar score, so it's possible that we'll have two players with 8-1 or one player with 9-0, because the 8-0 player will face a 7-1 in this situation.
We might have the case where the player who's 8-0 is completely guaranteed to go through. I mean, at this stage, both players are guaranteed to go through, so they might not care as much.
It depends. It really depends on the tiebreakers. I'm not sure which tiebreakers are we using and which one is more important than the other.
But so if you're 8-0, isn't there like a 100% chance?
Yeah, with 8-0, absolutely yes. But 8-0 will be playing against 7-1, and that 7-1 player might be feeling kind of uncomfortable.
Okay.
The big question is, if we have three players in the end with 8-1 score, does the 1-6-3 make it? Because some players still hope. They hope that because we have less players now, like some players drop out from the tournament, in case that we don't have the perfect score, we have three players with 8-1, maybe 1-6-3 will actually make it. So some people still continue playing because they hope. They ignore the math.
They feel like they can control the fate of their own destinies. It's really interesting to see. And let's go ahead and take a look at the player list so you guys understand what has happened so far. We have two players who are undefeated after 7 rounds. That is Hoi from Team Na'Vi and Purple from Gamers Origin. Then we have a couple of players that you might be familiar with. We featured them, in fact, two of them in the very first match, Super JJ and AK Wonder. Those guys are 6-1. RDU from Gamers 2, as well as Green Sheep, Toruk, a player that you were talking up a lot, Nimsh, Agara, Frezer, Born to Win, Bors, and Tomov. A lot of mix of good European players with some knowns and unknowns, and I think that's exactly what people want to see. Also, shout out to some of the 5-2 players who are sticking around here. Like we saw yesterday, Zedalot being able to close out his series and ultimately stay alive. Orange from Team Archon is another player that stands out. And then you have a couple of players who have been talked up a lot that's been waiting for a good performance. I'm looking at Legendarin and Martin Krieg as two of those names.
Yeah, also Freaky. So a lot of SK guys actually made it. Tomfler, who you mentioned before, Zettel, Zottel, those guys, and Hannibals, the winner of DreamHack Cluj-Napoca, those guys can still make it. They just need to win 2 more rounds. And if they win 2 more rounds, there is a really good chance they will make it, because 1-7-2 will probably not make it, the worst tiebreaker. So Hannibals being pretty low on the list, 32, but we are not sure if this is all 5-2s, right?
I think there's more 5-2s. I wasn't sure if Hyped actually is a 5-2, and he just wasn't, because he showed up early this morning to play.
He might be. He might be 5-2 as well.
So it's a lot of stuff that's on the line here. I know there's not everybody that's here competing that wants to continue here. Like some people just forfeit the rest of their games, but we're looking at all the players that showed up, and it's a pretty killer tournament so far.
Yep, it is. I'm really glad that we have this kind of approach when it comes to major tournaments, because it brings
legitimacy.
Exactly.
Sure.
It's early mornings. It brings a lot of value for the community, I think, because people are usually complaining about how the tournaments are looking in Hearthstone. And I think this is the second time DreamHack is doing something like this, bringing the Swiss tournament into our tournament environment. And I think this is something that is really well received by the community, and something that other tournaments organizers should look up to. And maybe organize some Swiss tournaments themselves. I mean, maybe online, it's also a very great tournament format for online play. So why not do tournaments with online qualifiers with Swiss, right?
I agree. I think it's something worth emulating as time goes on. You want to really flesh out some of the details. I think people are still getting used to the idea of playing, specific formats in Hearthstone, but this is definitely a great step in the right direction. So I'm pretty happy to see it. And today, I'm interested to see who's going to go to the top 8, because top 8 is where the points are. And the points are extremely valuable, because this is the first event of the year where you're going to be getting points. And the points really matter with shorter seasons. It's not like you have all year to, lollygag around and just take your time. I'll enter this tournament in January and ladder in March and then play another one in June. It's like, two seasons will pass by then. The earlier you get onto the board, the better. So getting those points ultimately might even mean more than the prize money itself to some of these players.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's amazing that we actually started a new season for the World Championships in November. So we have a full year of months. And like next month will be the first one where we can actually start gathering points. But if you win DreamHack right now, it's like winning November in your region.
Yes.
It's 15 points in the new ranking system, which is a lot.
It is, because it's the equivalent of finishing first on ladder for an entire season in your region. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, I guess if you're NA and you finish number one EU, it counts to your account as well.
And so it's even more important, actually, because right now with the new system, we have the quarter championships.
Yes, exactly.
So you are one of the first players to actually qualify for the preliminaries, and you will have a chance to qualify for BlizzCon as early as quarter one.
And that's win right. 100K.
It's a lot of money. It's a lot of money overall in Hearthstone. It's a lot of money here at DreamHack. Hope you guys are ready, because I believe day two is about to begin. Nimsh, what do we have as our first match here?
So we are going to start with Ekop and Sodal. Ekop from Cloud9, a Reno player. A lot of wins. Sodal, that's Ekop. Yeah, he doesn't have the glasses. That's really surprising. Klushnapoca, he was running the blue glasses. And he knows this is his moment. This is the elimination match. If he loses versus Sodal, he will not have a chance for top 16. He needs to win this one and win the next one as well. On the other hand, we have Sodal. Lothar, what do you know about Sodal?
Sodal, is, he was a few times my co-caster in different tournaments. And he's a very, very good analytical player. He's also known for making guides for Icy Veins. In my private opinion, he's one of the best players I know. He's really has a really great mindset. It's kind of salty sometimes, but at the same time, well, he knows how to play Hearthstone. And fun fact, he's also a pro in yo-yo, and we share a few friends that actually have this hobby. So it's really cool to see people with different, you know, background.
In competitive scene, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sodal is a yo-yo champion.
Yeah. That's really a sick yo-yo. Like player? No.
Yo-yoist.
Yo-yoist.
Exactly.
That's a new word.
He's a very talented nerd.
He's great at parties. He's great at parties. At parties, he can actually show you all the tricks with the things that he does.
Oh yeah, he's a hoot. Sodal is a player that I think people just really don't know much about, and maybe they've heard him cast, maybe they've seen him play a couple games here and there, but I think he'll be impressive today. And I know that the UK specifically has representatives that people feel like should be performing better. Generally speaking, UK has some pretty strong gamers, and in Hearthstone, a lot of their players tend to underperform at tournaments for some reason. I mean, when you think about it, who are some of the best UK players?
Modern Leper,
and you know, we think of other players,
Green Sheep,
Blackout from Dignitas. Yeah. Some of these guys, they haven't had the best results compared to, like, you know, Swedish players or the Dutch players or the German players, or you know, even to you guys, Narsen and Lothar. You guys have performed very well in tournaments. I think it's time for a UK player to have a real breakout performance.
Yeah, it's a big moment for Sodal as well. He can prove himself not only as just a caster and someone who writes articles, as a competitor as well, and which will give more weight to what he says is, on the desk as well.
Yeah. That's right.
Fun fact too, Raven should play in this tournament too, but he's actually casting.
He is, but he sold out and decided to become a caster. Please win my game for me.
You have to be good for him now.
I have to. Yeah, so I actually was playing Purple's Malley Ghost Warlock this morning to try to learn the deck a little bit, and they said, Frodan, the call time is now. You have to start the show. And I'm like, oh, I didn't even do my hair yet. So I look like a mess. And I'm like, Raven, please finish this game for me. And Raven's like, oh, yeah, sure, mate. And like, because he's always so happy. Like, Raven's always like, sure, mate, and I'll do anything for you.
It's actually so funny. The show is like, show starts in 15 seconds, and Frodan's like, I have Kesa Mystic. He played the secrets already.
And he plays Freezing Trap.
I updated him. Did we win that game?
You DC'd? You DC'd? What? Well,
bro,
that happens, Freddan. That happens.
I was at rank 1, 4 stars.
I should have tested.
Feels
for
bad,
you.
Man.
You still have the chance to get the legend.
I will. The moment I take a break, I'm going to walk around and play more of that Malley Ghost Warlock. It's a good deck.
It's a good deck. Now, by the way, we have two more players.
Yeah.
Because we have always two matches ready. Mm-hmm. So when we are done with Eco versus Sodal, we actually have Hannibal Z2 versus Orange.
Okay. So these two players, well, Orange is a player we've seen a couple times on the secondary stream. In fact, this has been the third time I think Orange has been on the second table. And he's waiting with Hannibal to feature the match if needed. Remember, both these guys are also at 5-2.
Yes.
Losing means they go home.
Yeah, and Hannibal is the winner of DreamHack Cluj-Napoca. He is from Bucharest, Romania. One of the players that surprised us because he wasn't known, but he's here, 5-2 versus Orange, so he is proving himself. If he defeats Orange and he eliminates Orange from the tournament and wins one more, he's again making a top 16 at DreamHack.
Mm-hmm. That'd be impressive.
And very, very cool to see him here, because when we talked with him after he won DreamHack Cluj-Napoca, I actually asked him, what will you do with the prize money you just won? And I suggested maybe she should just invest that in traveling for tournaments, and he's actually here in Sweden.
Cool.
So very cool to see from you know, the persistence from Hannibal.
Great stuff. Well, here we go. E-Cup versus Seoul. We have Cloud9 versus Complexity. Yeah. Someone was like, why didn't you ham up more of that British accent when Green Sheep was? Because I think Green Sheep has the fun, has one of the most fun UK accent there. It was like, oh, I'm James Liu. And I'm like, oh, man, I actually didn't do it at all. So now I have to bring it out. Like, oh, I'm Seoul. Anyways, he's playing the Paladin versus the Hunter. This is a really good opening for Ecop, I feel, because I think this is
insane.
The matchup he wanted. I mean, Druid's always kind of iffy these days. You're not that reliant upon it. So Hunter is usually designed to outpace the Paladin and try to kill it, assuming you can get it without the Paladin curving very well. Chow into mini bot into muster for battle will probably destroy any Hunter opening.
It's so important also because it's last hero standing. So Ecop actually has a chance to kill the Paladin ending up in a good matchup instead of Paladin killing his other decks like Patron or I don't actually know which deck is he playing. Is he playing Patron or Control Warrior? But I feel like Paladin might be okay versus both of those decks.
That's a good point.
I know Ecop for like 9 years now, and I'm still not sure if he is now just bored or super focused.
Or hungover.
I would say he's super focused. This is his super serious face.
It is.
So it's not like normally when Ecop is playing, when he's feeling good, he's having fun, he's like cheerful, just showing funny faces. But this is his super serious. He knows this is his moment and he needs to win both of the matches. Like not only solo, he's thinking about both matches, but you need to take one match at a time.
Yeah. Well, it's a really good point. One game is all you have to focus on right in front of you. We have Aldor Peacekeeper onto the Misha, and that's almost as good as it gets in this early game for tempo.
So you want to kill Misha instantly just to play around on Master, but probably won't. That's not even in Ecop's deck.
You see an abusive Sergeant, so the chances of Houndmaster are much lower already. But I think it's just important to kill it because you just don't know if that's going to end up punishing you for holding on to one more. Like, you unleash the Hounds and just hits face with everything, and you're like, well, I just generated a lot more damage from my opponent.
Also, Solo is playing the midrange Warlock. We see the Lion Hand. So for now, he just wants to limit the damage as much as possible because he should be able to win a late game.
Yes, assuming the game could go on, Lion Hands can be powerful, but I think True Server Champion might be the heal he actually really cares about because that might buy him that turn to get to Lay on Hands. So having both those in tandem can be equally important. Now, this is a really interesting turn from Ecop because he has multiple ways he can develop here onto the board, whether the Pilot Shredder, which does get contested by the Elder Peacekeeper, or the Haunted Creepers, which are stickier and more annoying.
I think that
but the only beast that he has in his hand, and it might be a case when he would like stick to one Haunted Creeper in his hand for the late game for the kill commands, you know? So I think Pilot Shredder will be just much better here.
He was probably thinking about Abusive as well. Like, what is the merit with Abusive killing the 3-3 and playing 100 Creeper? Because when you play Shredder, it's going to be contested by the 3-3. But I think ultimately it was a better play.
All right, we'll see what happens after the Shredder gets popped here. There's multiple ways to go about this. Sado chooses to trade more of his life, so that way his board can be preserved. And if it's a 2-attack health or lower, sorry, 2-attack minion or lower, it gets paid off, and that is reward for that sequencing. Otherwise, he would have traded health and he lost his board.
Freezing Chop is not good for Ecop. He wants to pressure more, so he might be forced to play.
It might be very good for Ecop.
Might be
it's
time
six
to start hero powering, though.
Yes. This is 6 damage this turn, and you don't care about a Freezing Chop right now. So it seems like a great turn for Ecop.
Yeah, but Freezing Chop is something that you probably don't want that much. Like something, a kill command, quick shot. Maybe something bigger would be better.
Guess it's time to consecration here. But do you attack with the Aldor Peacekeeper? Because if you lose this 3-1, how are you going to try to contest on the board, especially if you think it's Explosive Trap? It might be important to challenge the next minion with that Peacekeeper as well.
Maybe well, the Truce of a Champion might be important. In case of a second Pilot Shredder or Animal Companion, because you have no other means of testing the
Sure, yeah. That makes sense.
And you don't have Zombie Chow to contest the trap. Leper, no. Well, That is 2 damage, but...
It's very important to see that now the Lay on Hands will be getting better and better because Sottl is gaining board control. And
yes.
This is the only way you can play Lay on Hands when you have board control. At least one minion to just kill something that's playing a board.
Something to note, too, is that the Freezing Trap is playable, so...
That means it's a second trap.
It could be a Snake Trap. It also could be an Explosive Trap as well.
It's a very weird combination if you play both Freezing Trap and Explosive Trap, because it feels like counterproductive, especially if you play Mad Scientist, because, an example, the Explosive Trap will be after Freezing Trap, played after Freezing Trap, so you can't really kill a minion because he will bounce back to your opponent's hand. So I would guess this might be a different trap.
I think Explosive Trap in the current metagame at this kind of tournament is right, because you will play against a lot of local players, so you can expect a lot of aggro decks. So I would not blame him for playing just 2 freezing, 1 explosive, or double explosive, 1 freezing.
Mm-hmm. Now it's getting really weird. Ekop is still in the dominant position, while Sottl is getting really low. Even with the attack of Thrusilla Champion, he will get 13 HP, so basically the Leper Gnome will put him effectively at 9 if the zombie troll will attack, because then the Thrusilla Champion has to attack into Leper Gnome.
But then the secret also could add more damage to that as well, so
exactly.
It's just such a complicated series of events.
What you might do here, you might consider Aldor.
I think the first thing you should do is zombie troll face to see if it's Explosive Trap. Because Explosive Trap is actually less threatening than Snake Trap.
Interesting choice of playing Sylvanas.
It's less damage, but and it also doesn't trigger a kill command.
Yep.
Interesting choice of playing Sylvanas earlier, because now it will be easier to actually attack with Sylvanas into something
and trade
steal
it.
Very good chance, because it's important to have that kind of advantage right now.
Oh, that's a lot of damage. And that's a turn before Lay on Hands. This is very bad for Sottl.
So that's 5, 7. And, can you deal 1 damage to your own Sylvanas to take the Leper Gnome back?
It might not matter ultimately.
He still needs to taunt as well, because there is the weapon.
He needs
so
to stop damage.
He can.
He can actually steal a minion, yeah.
He can steal the Leper Gnome?
Yes, he can.
It doesn't
but
matter,
it doesn't really
though.
Matter, because he will be killed. Ultimately, he will be killed.
And the spiders
that's a
are there
fancy
well.
Play, though. I mean, that play has a pinky sticking out on it, but it's not really going to matter much here.
Yeah, so is there anything? Probably not, right? He can't heal. He can't taunt. There is so much damage incoming. He can't deal with all the minions.
When you think about it, Eagle Humbo was the best draw that Eco could have got.
6 damage out of 3 mana.
Well, just any kind of damage. I think even if it was a charger, it'd be really good too. Mm. Like if it was Arcane Golem. Because the whole point is that you put the damage to potentially kill next turn.
Yeah. But the Eagle Humbo is guaranteed 2 attacks. If it's a charger, then it can get killed, take the other minion. Yes, and Bow is practically an immovable object for Paladin. Because no one plays Harrison Jones.
Yeah,
we
mean,
actually seen the one
only,
on stream.
The only way it could have gotten worse was if he stole like the Leper Gnome and killed the Arcane Golem. But then even then, he still had 3 damage with Haunted Creeper. So it's like, in essence, he just needed to generate enough damage to put him on a 2-turn clock,
yeah,
which he did.
The Creeper dies, so there are the Spectral Spiders as well. So pretty tough loss for Sottl. I wonder if there was some mind games involved. Maybe Sottl thought like Ico will not start with the Hunter, because Hunter was the counter to the Paladin. But he got caught in that one, and Paladin is out for him. Ico just continues with the Hunter, because that's the winning deck.
All right, well, Sottl's going to go with the Zoo Warlock, it looks like, to take out this Hunter.
It's
which is
actually Druid, I think.
It's an aggressive Druid.
Druid, yeah.
With Echoing Ooze and
so
Haunted Creeper.
What type... Well, okay, Echoing Ooze was played in Druid because it...
are you
Power
sure?
Of the Wild?
I'm pretty sure this looks like a token zoo.
Well,
like
okay.
if you look at those if you look at those 3 cards.
Yes, you're right.
Yeah. I mean, I guess I was looking at the overlay wrong, but
yeah.
But the we all know that that was a Druid with Echoing Oozes before because of Savage Roar.
And I would not really be surprised if Sol actually innovates here and brings a new deck to the tournament. That will actually be really surprising
well,
to see.
It wouldn't be the first time we saw this token zoo, in fact, in this tournament. I think Elky was playing something similar too. And the primary thing about Dark Peddler is that it gives you a lot of versatility to continue to have like a good curve, which is the most important thing here against the Hunter. You need to be able to curve out very strong. He's going to hit face with this. Wow, look at that move! He hits face with the Abusive Sergeant because he doesn't want to be in a position of very defensive against Hunter. He wants to be proactive.
I really like the Dark Peddler and Gormrok combination because Dark Peddler most of the time is providing you with a small minion for one mana as well, so you can extend your board and then Gormrok will actually work. And
yeah.
This is not a bad matchup though.
No, it makes sense considering that he attacked with Abusive Sergeant. He wants Ecop to potentially be baited into hitting face so he has more minions for Gormrok to be activated, ultimately having really powerful board tempo.
The problem is Ecop has already an explosive threat trap in his hand, and this allows him to make a comeback even though his opponent is more aggressive than him.
Right.
Oh, wow. Ecop, great.
There it is.
I'm really surprised by that.
And
really surprised.
Because Sato's attack allowed him to do that, that's why it's like, wow, that was an awesome attack there from Sato. He sneaked in 2 more damage.
I think it's fine, though. Like, he's protecting his Knife Juggler, so...
I mean, I would just not play the Knife Juggler here because you need the Knife Juggler against Zoo to make a comeback. If
not
you're using explosive trap,
you have explosive trap.
Yeah, but you could use that combination in two because most of the minions from Zoo will not die with those like on
what
one HP.
What was the other play though? Like, you would just point the bow and just attack the minions.
Yes.
Wow.
The tempo of the bow is very, very important.
Look at that.
This is
now he has
good.
Four minions on board.
Yeah. Gormrok is enabled.
Dude, Elven Archer.
This might be
Clutch.
The explosive chop
that was
turn,
the
though.
Best card for Gormrok activation next turn. Because
yeah.
How else do you kill it in tempo?
Yeah, but now it's just
explosive chop, so Gormrok is out.
Well, that's fine. Why don't you just Gormrok and then not do anything?
Yeah, that's a good turn. I mean, it's probably the best possible way of playing this game because you know that your opponent played already one Knife Juggler, so there's almost no possibility of having a second one with the Hounds already in hand.
What are you waiting for, though?
Okay. So
I think like attacking makes sense in a way that you don't want to just get locked by Explosive Chop.
Okay.
You want to develop fine. Something this turn.
Well, that's what I was saying. Gormrok is going to attack, but this does the most damage and it gives him time to develop the game boss. He did miss an opportunity to generate another single 1-1, but I think he'd rather have the Imp Gang boss healthier for board trades.
Yeah, 2-4 is really annoying for Hunter.
Until he gets a freezing trap.
Yeah, the natural play will be freezing trap and ball and obtain board control and additional damage, so it's very nice. But I would pass on the attack here because you need the weapon to trade for the sin if your opponent doesn't trigger the freezing trap right now.
My trade, go face!
Tap with no guarantee of a play.
Oh.
Yikes.
Ooh. And you can't play the owl because it silences your own.
Oh, man. And you know what? If he was able to use Imp Gang Boss proactively to get that single 1-1 target, it might have made a much different outcome. One of those things that, even though it might be suboptimal for what you want to accomplish, it ends up being a case where you corner yourself by doing that.
Yeah, it's it's kind of like next level. Would you ever expect a freezing chop and prepare situation? I think a 2-4 had a lot of merit to it. But this is the second time we see this Warlock. Elky was playing it before on stream as well, and it wasn't that successful. It seems like the cards that are really conditional, like Giants and Gormrok, they are kind of like win more cards, and it don't work
no.
if you don't get the board.
In fact, I actually disagree. I think. Well, I mean, I can understand why you think that, but I would say that because of Sea Giants and Gormrok, that's the reason you can win in this matchup against Hunter. In fact, Sea Giant is your primary win condition against Hunter, generally speaking, because there's going to be a point where you just need to kill him in 2 turns, and Sea Giant is the only way you can do it for 16 damage. But generally speaking, I don't really like Gormrok the Impaler. I know Reynad's obsessed about it. So I do agree on that point that I think I'd rather just have like a big power play card that I can always use. So even if it's what's the card? The Iron dwarf thing? Dark Iron
Dwarf. Dark Iron Dwarf, yeah.
Sometimes I'd rather even just have that card because you always have tokens and you can always buff it.
It was actually being played for some time. But to counter your argument, if players know what they are playing against, like if you know you're playing versus a giant zoo, instead of going for phase, you will actually focus on killing the minions. Hence giving the Warlock less chances to actually play the giant.
But look, I mean, now it's the point where he's going to get this Defender of Argus back.
I just wanted to
point
out
that he can play a Sea Giant too.
There would be a huge difference if Sotho wouldn't tap on turn 5 and just play Gormog
as for a 4-4.
As in, you know, just in, not exactly effective turn. And putting an underpowered minion on board, but it would have been more important than the potential four damage to a minion into the face, which, you know, this is like basically like a charge minion. But you do it the same, you have the exact same outcome if you just put it on board.
I agree. That's another thing that I didn't really consider. One thing that you have to also think about too is that by playing the Freezing Trap this way, he also denied him the Sea Giant at a cheaper cost, allowing him to possibly do something more. I mean, he can Iron Beak Owl and then attack, but he can't play his Defender of Argus again. And
well, it's not extendable, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, if you want to taunt the Giant.
Wait, wasn't he able to play both Hunter Creeper and Giant?
Yes, if he was able to attack first. Wait, no, because he'd be killing a minion and gaining one, so
But he could have
neutral.
Still have...
he would have had one mana floating.
But he could have just leave Defender of Argus on board.
Yeah, so he'd have one mana, but he'd kill a minion and generate one.
Leave
so he'd
defender,
have one extra mana.
Leave Defender, play Hunted Creeper, attack into the minion, and
with
then
what? With the Imp? And they get Imp frozen?
Oh, yeah, right.
Yeah, he would lose one.
No,
minion,
never mind. Yeah.
Although, I mean, it might be worth noting that maybe he has an extra minion on board and he plays Haunted Creeper, gaining another mana crystal. I mean, it's something that I kind of have to look at because the screen
what
is a little bit far. So I can't really read the mana cost.
I think that
right
was
now.
Fine. Like, Haunted Creeper was basically, he could have played it instead of the Owl, but playing the Owl allowed him to kill the minion.
Yeah.
So
you could be right, Lothar, though. Anyways, the important thing that he did was play Sea Giant. Now. And now that he knows that he has Defender of Argus, this actually is a way to win the game.
Yes. Because you have that Defender of Argus in there.
Right. And for Ekop, the most important thing is killing next turn. So he's going to just most likely all in on the board here. He's choosing not to take any damage whatsoever, not even using his own weapon swing here.
That's very weird. I mean,
wow, look at this. Oh my god. He's going to have two Sea Giants with Defender of Argus.
And he has a Gormok.
Well, he will not be able to play Gormog this turn if he chooses to go Sea Giant Defender.
Yeah, Lothar was just kidding. He was just saying like how Gormog stuck in the hand for so long. Dude, what an insane power turn. Ekop knows exactly what time it is. It's like, am I playing against Handlock or am I playing against Zoo? It's kind of the same thing.
Yeah, well, it's Warlock, so, you know.
And that's it. He should be locked out. Like, what is he going to do from this point on? You can kill the 5-2.
Yeah.
And then just hit.
You have a setup for lethal next turn, and that
should
be it.
He needs quick shot kill commands. Oh my god.
Can he get a kill command? Yeah, so he can go Huffer into
but
quick
what
shot.
What does Huffer do?
It helps kill the giants, and he can get something cool off the Shredder. Oh
so
no, that's not
well,
good.
Well, Misha. Wait a second.
Misha stalls.
Misha stalls, but Gormog might make a difference here.
Yeah, Gormog might actually win the game.
Well, hold on, we'll see. First, let's see what the quick shot draws, because he's definitely going to quick shot. Most likely, he's going for the face.
Oh my!
The dream,
God.
But he's not enough mana.
Oh man,
he
so
hasn't enough mana.
Well, he has
mana.
To kill the giant, right?
Yeah, he does, or he's going to die.
So why wouldn't you
quick shot
the
giant?
Because right?
It's effectively health.
Yes.
In case he drew an Iron Peak out,
it would
maybe?
Be weird. No, like the quick shot giant means like.
Wow.
That was so good.
Dude,
gross.
And then Gormog kills him!
Now. Wait, what if he has second explosive trap?
Oh, you're right.
Yeah,
maybe he cashes in Scientist?
He can still play Gormog after that.
I think there's very little reason
to keep
Scientist.
He can play Hunter Creeper and get the Gormog board.
Wow!
That's kind of too late to the party.
What a crazy minion that would have been if he was able to attack twice. But
oh,
that's
and
it.
He doesn't have a second explosive trap
that's
in
it.
His set deck.
Gormok, the Impaler.
Gormok finish.
Rain at the Prophet.
Reynard has a super prop. He has like to get that tingling sensation, you know?
Yeah.
You
know, somewhere in the world, someone is playing Impaler for 4 damage, and Reynard is like raising his hair on his end. You know?
I'm sure Forsen gets a sensation. Somebody actually played Gormok correctly. Yeah.
Somewhere in the world, someone's sniping Reynard, even if he's not streaming. That's for sure. So that is a 1-1 score.
I'm impressed.
Zoo Warlock against Hunter. Dude, you were doubting it, but look at the power of it in some of those scenarios.
Sea Giants were really good. And there was, he was missing some mana, but the Sea Giant power.
Granted, we look at the Gormok save, and it's, you know, flashy for the final kill, but if the Gormok was on board,
yeah, it would be better.
You don't know if that ends up being the reason why he doesn't take that much damage, or he trades better on board, or even has better Defender Vargas to push, because that becomes a 5-5 instead of a 4-4. And
what if...
It's very interesting the way things pan out that way.
Was there any way for Ekop to deal more damage if he actually attacks...
Well, he could have gotten his weapon instead of. He actually lost 2 damage from the Lotus.
Yeah, so he had lethal.
Oh,
so
yeah, you're right. He chose to take less damage and go for it.
Yeah,
right.
If he would attack with the weapon and then go 5 damage to face with Lotus,
he would have won. He didn't believe in the quick shot dream.
Yes.
And that is the difference between.
To blame.
he traded too much.
Yep.
And he didn't face enough.
Oh, my God.
Trade cup. That's what happens, man.
Trade cup, yeah.
Well, Sottle has new life because now he has to take this Warlock deck and pilot it against another really tough matchup, which is the Patron Warrior.
Yeah, but that's a really good opening, I think. Like he got a lot of small minions. He just needs to get more power, but the start, he's going to bring those minions that are actually tough to deal with.
I wonder if Ico will attack into the Divine Shield. He should.
Kind of want to. Yep. But actually, you don't want to, but you probably should. You have a Death Spite as well, so... Ultimately, you're just going to need to be swinging.
Dark Battle into Voidwalker.
Dude, Shield Bearer is nuts!
Reynard is just like, I don't know what Reynard is thinking right now.
He is manifesting himself.
Reynard is like, why am I not playing this tournament?
He's manifesting himself as he's taking the Immortal Coil. Wow. He has Voidwalkers, I think. So it's like he's got the...
just wanted to see the Shield Bearer.
Shield Bearer, man. Such a nuts card against Warrior with a Fear War X.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. maybe he feels like Mortal Coil allows him to cycle more effectively into his bigger threats, because ultimately, Shield Bearer won't win you the game, but Dr. Boom, Sea Giants, and yes, even Gormok the Impaler might win you the game compared to that. And then, you know, I wonder if he has other cards like the Reliquary Seeker. This is a card that a lot of people doubt, and they don't feel like it's very good.
I doubt it myself.
I think it's...
I raised it to trash. 2 out of 10.
2 out of 10?
Yeah, that was...
I think it's okay in this deck.
I don't think
it's a heavy lifter, but I think it's okay.
Many times you don't want to fill your board because of explosive chops and other stuff. And we've seen Seeker before.
But it's amazing against Druid, but why would you push your deck against Druid when it's already good?
Pretty good against this deck too, if he's able to get a few more tokens out and push it out. But we'll see. Right now, Ekop is in a very uncomfortable position because of the curve from Zottle has been very nice.
I mean, he has 2 AoEs in his hand already. If he attacks into the egg, spawns the spider. The spider gets the AoE effect, so it will be at 4/3.
Execute.
Then you can execute the spider and still just leave Defender of Argus with the ghoul on board. Defender of Argus will be left at 2/1.
You can have stable armorsmith as well before, right? Just get more armor.
Yeah, I don't think that's necessary. I think you can just leave the armor smith on 1/4.
Yeah, it's a good point. Maybe Ekop feels really good with the 2 executes, because the first one will probably go on the Nerubian, but if not, it goes into the Sea Giant, and that's pretty good.
Yeah, it's pretty good overall. But I like the new Zoo, guys. It really feels like a Zoo. At some point, Zoo didn't feel like Zoo. It was more mid-rangey with all the demons and like war colors. And Zoo essentially should be a lot of small minions. And there is a giant or two in the deck, obviously, but small peddlers, Argent Squire, really feels like the other.
For some new players that just joining the tournament, It's important to know that the death rattle effects are triggered by the order of minions being played on board.
Yep.
So, not on minions, but cards played on board. So the death rattle from Death Spider was played after after the egg, because it was later played on the board than the egg.
Look at what Sato has. He has that Mortal Coil, which allows him to kill off this
Nerubian egg,
because the whirlwind effect after the death rattle on the Upstable Ghoul puts it as a 0-1.
Yeah, draw a card as well. Oh, you can also draw a card from Petra.
Yeah, this is to keep the egg healthier. Okay. Ultimately, I think this might be insurance against Brawl.
Well, even if there is no Brawl, just double Whirlwind is awkward as well. What's Patron wants to do?
Oh, wait, this is not Control War, it's Patron War.
Yeah, exactly. Yep.
Yeah.
So you kind of want to have the egg untouched if you are pressing with the board anyway.
But does Hotel already know it's Patron?
He's seen
Battle Rage. He saw Battle Rage. Yeah, I think that's the big giveaway. Slam comes down. And that means Sea Giant is still too expensive. He's going to go for a life tap here, trying to draw into other minions that curve out. And Echoing Ooze is not bad. It's just more minions that are annoying.
A fun fact here, that because the matchup changed so much in favor for Sue, because there are no charge minions, no charging patrons to clear the board, also he can tap more recklessly.
Yeah.
Tap of whirlwinds.
Oozes are so gross, man. Yeah, you have the two whirlwinds. But I think Dr. Boom might still be your best chance.
Oh my god, zero mana Sea Giant.
Yeah, well, Dr. Boom is pretty good because it's giving up the board. But how much damage is there incoming? If you kill the biggest minion, which is 2-1, you have 4 damage. So you should be feeling pretty good about it.
That's right. This deck generally has cut the Doom Guards out of the equation. Because you don't really play the Voidcaller package anymore. Instead, you play more Sea Giants, more token approaches, and you have a board-centric approach.
Maybe.
Yeah, Gormok as well. So you will be stuck with some additional cards at some point if you don't want to sum the Doom Guard.
Wow, he's going to go for a full trade and double Whirlwind and kill off. And this really limits your Grim Patriot on the following turns, but it keeps you alive and you have board.
Well, he's going for this because of the Sea Giant, right? Like, don't want to see a Sea Giant that early.
I mean, you still... Oh, man.
Yeah, that would be double Sea Giant if he would not do that.
Yeah, it's a good point. Double Sea Giants would have changed it.
That's
huh.
Not that good draw.
That is interesting.
What are you
Ben
doing
Brother's at? Laughing right now.
He probably
somewhere
is.
In the world. 4 times more probable to draw a class card.
And he loses his big Game Hunter? So then Dr. Boom!
Oh man, that was pretty tough.
Oh man!
That was huge actually.
Wow!
Slight BM.
Oh.
Was it necessary? Was it Soulfire
necessary? Was Soulfire
necessary?
No, but it... Well... I don't know, man. It's one of those things where you can always say it's not necessary, but he might feel like if he loses board, then patrons and everything, he'll just continue to dominate. This is a case, by the way, where the Sea Giant will also be able to contest Dr. Boom and maybe be able to absorb a lot of damage.
There is an execute, though.
Ah, you're right. Second Sea Giant, but does he have enough time? Because he might just die by then.
Yeah, Dr. Boom will be pretty good. He can now attack with the bomb and hope the bomb actually hits the 8-8.
And now he has Battle Rage with at least 2 card draws from Dr. Boom. If he is able to damage it somehow.
It's probably mostly 1 card. You might want to go for face and start actually erasing Zoo here. You're in a pretty good position. You know you can clear this board as he cop. And then Zoo is behind, so something like the Big Defender Vargas is probably not possible. Mm-hmm. Especially because the deck is so based on the board. If you don't have the board, it's hard to play your cards and do anything.
Wait, what? I'm just going for battle rage for 1?
Yeah, because you are not going to damage the bombs. And you want Dr. Boom to go to face.
Yeah, you could put him on a 2-turn. Like, practically speaking, most likely you're going to 2-turn lethal him with this.
I was just thinking it's not necessary to battle rage at all. Yeah, but Acolyte, a trade with Execute, and a weapon. And now just put on board and...
Well, he didn't have the weapon until he drew Battle Rage. So you don't really know that for sure.
But the Acolyte, I think, is still...
Well, Acolyte is not putting any pressure on board, and he wants to have some pressure to actually win next turn. So if you Battle Rage into something like a second Shredder, Belcher, Waltham...
That Reliquary Seeker.
So he's
man,
playing
I
it!
I bet he really wished that Sea Giant was a Doctor... Or not a Doctor Broom, but a big game hunter for the Doctor Broom.
Yep.
So this is exactly what I said. Like, if the opponent knows how to deal with your board, you have all the conditional cards. You can't do anything with them. So E-Cup is taking game number 3.
Yikes.
Saying it's a 1.
And that's bad news for Solid, because the Druid these days, especially if it's aggressive, is tends to be very susceptible to the Patron Warrior. So E-Cup is in a 2-1 position with a very dominant chance to just take this game and stay alive in the tournament. Remember, they're both 5-2.
Yeah.
They're on the verge of elimination.
Loser is eliminated. The winner still has a chance to get the top 16. We'll need to win one more match and hope his tiebreakers are okay. Because the worst 7-2 probably doesn't make it. He's going to get a 17th place, which feels bad.
Well, still thinking about the match. Like, the Zushra, I think it was not aggressive enough. Like, the plays that the Sotl chose were too defensive. Like, especially the Soulfire.
I think the Soulfire I can identify. I think if you Soulfired and he discarded one Sea Giant, he'd have the board, right? Because he could kill the Armorsmith 2-2 for 2-1, or 1-2. And then he can use that board for everything else that he wants to leverage, which eventually he drew, right? The Abusive Sergeant, etc. I can understand why. It just didn't end up working out that well. Sottl goes for the mulligan and gets no Wild Growth, no Darnassus Aspirant. We'll see what he gets on turn 1 draw here.
He needs something, because this matchup is all about Druid having the board to counter the Patrons. If you don't get that, you're in a very bad position.
And meanwhile, E-Cop does actually have early game plays. That's another thing that could sabotage the Warrior, just drawing spells like Whirlwinds. But if you don't have it, then early on, you're just going to be stuck not really doing much. But in this case, E-Cop does have options available to him.
Yeah, and the new version of Pendant, I'm not exactly sure which version is he playing, but I would assume he's playing the minion one. So more with the Belchers instead of Nomish Inventors. Less draw, more actual beefy minions. So if you have that, with the Ballad to Shredder, he has a really nice curve overall.
All right, passes over to Sottl, who needs ramp now. Wrong 2 mana card.
It's so cool for Adam that the Patron actually survived. It's a balanced deck.
I like this. Old school moves. This is my like. So what you do is you don't attack with the Druid hero power because you don't want to make Battle Rage draw a card here. So even though you could attack and put him at 29, you don't feel like that one attack difference is the key. And you know what? E-Cop just so happened to have Battle Rage in hand.
Yeah, I think it's worth mentioning that Sottl is actually a Patron expert. When we were casting Divinity with him, he really knew all the math, and he always was spotting the correct place.
Yep. Patron. He is a really good Patron player, but the old iteration of Patron Warrior with the Warzone Commanders and disgusting damage from Frowning Berserker
so
was just a way different deck than it, it is now.
Now it's more like mid-range, the minions.
Yeah, these days, Patron Warrior has taken a mid-range board-centric approach. The finishers of choice are Dr. Boom and Gromash, just because of the potency behind what you can do with it.
You can still win with the Patrons if you just explode with 4 to 6 Patrons and the opponent has
certainly
nothing to do with them.
I mean, it is one of your win conditions. This is another one, too, the Frothing Berserker that goes unchecked, but it should be dealt with. This is a high-priority removal for Druid, whether they want to silence it or we want to just remove it directly. With the Keep of the Grove, what you can do is keep Innervate for the Drake next turn and allow you to Innervate Wrath. And that might be something he evaluates. Depends on what he draws, though. Like, he might have a 7-mana card that comes to the hand, and he wants to innervate that instead.
Well, there are 3 cards with 7 mana, so I think that's actually not the correct.
Well, I mean, either you develop the Keep of the Grove, or you just Wrath it down. I think he feels more okay playing it defensively here.
Yeah, I think Wrath is fine. Keeper is mostly used as a silence for Aqua the Faint in this matchup.
Sure.
Or like one of the ways to deal with Patrons sometimes even.
True, very true. Actually, that's a really good point. Maybe he feels like he needs that as insurance as time goes on.
Alright, for Ikaba was super easy turn, just got the with the Shredder. And he got Dr. Boom as well, which can be a turn 6 play. So it's for now it's looking really good, even though he doesn't have the Patience or like some combo elements.
But he's got a great turn 5. If he can get some damage onto his minions, he can play Acolyte, Inner Rage, and Battle Rage and just fill up his hand.
Yeah, Ikaba is in a good position here. And Soddle is trying to defend, and it's never good if you are with your back to the wall as a druid.
Two Drakes is certainly interesting. It's much more aggressive on the digging and cycling part of your deck. In fact, some druids have cut Azure Drake altogether and put Sludge Belcher in the deck because they want to be more defensive. And so Soddle wants to have the tempo on his side, but you know he's not even able to capitalize on this Innervate, which he's drawn a few turns ago. And the Innervate just gets worse as time goes on.
Absolutely. That weapon is a great pickup, not only because he can deal with the Shade, but also because he can take damage as well, enabling Battle Rage, one more card from it at least.
That's right. Like, you know, it's not very intuitive to think like, oh, I want to be losing some health here, but in this scenario, it's actually very strong for Ikaba to go for this for card draw purposes in later turns. Like, he doesn't have to Battle Rage now, because he'll only be able to get one card, maybe two. But I think ultimately what he really wants to accomplish here is just to be set up for the future turns. Because after Dr. Boom, can he finish the game from that position?
Yeah, and he can play Dr. Boom on turn 6 because of the point. So clear the board here, probably kill Dazzle Trick as well.
Soddle's getting nervous. You can see him taking really deep breaths, tapping his pen a little bit furiously. And you know what? He doesn't even need coin.
Wow.
He's got pint-sized sub here. Wow. That's going to reduce Dr. Boom to 6 mana.
Yeah.
And there is the true Dr. Six. Where is your god now, Paladins?
Well, there's a Keeper Wrath, not to, like, you know, poop on the party, but there's an easy way out here.
Oh, you mean you kill the gnome?
He says not to poop on the party, proceeds to poop on the party. Wow. You're going to be a great father, Lothar.
Yeah, I know.
I can teach you some dad jokes if you want.
I'm not good at dad. I told you that yesterday.
Nah, you'll be just fine, honey. I'm expecting soon anyways. You're going to wrath the pint-sized summoner, but that won't stop Dr. Boom from coming out. And more importantly, there's not a very strong answer from Soddle because he's not the big game hunter. He has to swipe that thing down.
Well, it's okay because you have Azure Drake and Innervate Swipe, right? So you can kill everything.
Oh yeah, you're right. Actually, I didn't see that.
And trade with Keeper, so it's not horrible, especially if the bombs are just like kind of, you know, anxious to kill the Azure Drake.
Yeah, okay. It's alright. It's alright.
But if it does clear the board, that's not very good news.
Oh yeah, that's kind of horrible. So all hopes in Boombots.
Actually, even if one of the Boombots hits for one, it's still alright for Ikaba because he can just finish Azure Drake with the weapon.
Yeah, that's true. And he also has whirlwinds with like Battle Rage and stuff. So Ikaba would still feeling pretty good in this position. So let's see if Soddle choose to go for the swipe. You know what's really cool with the Azure Drake first? You might even pick up Big Game Hunter.
Yeah, that would be huge, actually. It's always good to kill Boom with Big Game Hunter. Not only you develop the minion, you also get the tempo. That's not it, though, but...
That's another back pickup for next turn.
Yeah, good sequencing there.
And now the moment of...
Azure Drake, can you survive?
And, I mean, there's two Boom Bots. Double your chances. Four and...
Oh,
four.
My God.
I mean,
double fours.
That might be really important because Ikaba wants to kill him as fast as possible.
But does Soddle want to keep that Drake alive? Like, what if you said you either choose between Drake dying or you take 8 damage? Which one would you choose?
Well, you would still take 4 damage in the face because 4 damage to the Drake will actually kill it.
Right, but you could choose either Drake dying or you could...
I would always take the 8 damage to the face.
Yeah, so I think...
I would pick 2 damage to the face and Drake surviving.
I think this is the lesser of two evils for Soddle. You expect Boombots to have a high impact, but dang, that was really a painful exchange.
I mean, when you think about it, the 8 damage to the face is around 6 mana worth. So that's kind of huge. It's not even about the card advantage, but it's just 6 mana.
Sure. Yeah. I feel you.
Oh, that Battle Rage. And
pretty
he can
big.
Still kill the Astral Drake. He's full health almost. So Ikaba in a good position.
Oh man.
Well. And that Grommash and Taskmaster just counting that 8 damage. He's getting closer and closer to just winning the game.
Especially with Deathbite coming up on the next couple of turns here. It's going to be huge.
Yeah, he should be able to clear the board next turn and then just prepare for the Grommash finisher. So now, solo side, what do you do? How do you...
Man, you really do want to kill that unstable ghoul or do something about it, like silence it or pop it, because you don't want Grim Patrons to be able to flood the turn following. And that gives you... Well, you can either Savage Roar Lothabit, or you can use Keeper of the Grove and develop the Pilot Shredder. So I think the two minion plan is much better with two Savage Roars.
It's definitely better to just put some minions on the board instead of a loaded.
Yep. Yeah,
even though this Pilot Shredder is being contested by the free one.
Oh man, and the tension just keeps on building here. You can develop Deathbite and the Defiling Berserker set up for a Grommash kill.
How much damage can you deal this turn? So if you attack with both of them to the face, that's 7, you put them on 13, maybe hero powers, and you will have exactly 14 with Grommash next turn. And you still make him do something with the Frothing.
Yeah, the thing about that is, if he plays like Druid the Claw Taunt, Grommash, how do you get through? You'd have to attack Whirlwind, and then Grommash would still go through, actually. So
yeah, but you don't have lethal then, but
yeah,
still.
It's a good point.
Like, now it's all about, do you risk it that they don't have the taunts? Because you don't even, like, after Lothab, you still win. You don't need any spells. You have Grommash and Deathbite.
It's true.
Are you? Is there any possibility that you're dead? You're at 23, there are 2 minions on board, you will have a taunt.
No. Really. It seems like you will just barely survive to a Force Nature Savage Roar.
Alright. I can understand going to the safe as well. Grommash can still be played
kind
with
of
this.
Hilarious. Mana Wraith.
Yeah,
Mana stopping Lothar from being played for 5. That is a Force Nature Savage Roar for 18 damage.
And I think that's the time when I should drop that.
What if you Lothab and just Savage Roar now and hit face? You trade the 5-4 and you hit face with the other one.
What about just going for the combo now? And then killing the 5-4 and going the rest of the face and trying to get Force Nature next turn and just win?
I think Lothab does amplifies your damage for Force Nature Savage Roar next turn though, right? Because what's the chances of him...
Well, he will just use his death spread, right? To kill... I mean, if you don't kill... The Frothing Berserker?
Yeah, you
just
you
die.
You definitely kill it. But then you just play the Lothab afterwards and you combo. I really like this play from Zottl.
Yeah, it's alright.
Because now, you know what? He can go to 21. And that's actually going to be exact lethal. He has to use Grom to not die.
Well, he can also just... If he kills Lothab, he goes down to 14 and he can armor up. So that combo doesn't kill him.
Yeah.
But then he doesn't develop Grommash.
Yeah, he doesn't develop Grommash. Also, he loses his Deathbite, which is just weaker for a lot of stuff in the future. So he has to be like, well, he used one Savage Roar. Am I going to put my opponent on having another Force Nature Savage Roar?
Yeah, this is actually pretty good play by Solo. He is locking that Grommash. And he is actually having a chance to win the game right there if Ikop goes for the bait.
Yeah.
So if Ikop feels like there is the combo in the hand, what
maybe
is the best play here?
If the combo is in the hand, his best play is to probably end up playing Grommash just straight up on the board.
What
like
about
you can attack Grommash with a 5/5 hit phase or something.
Yeah,
with
yeah,
weapon.
Yeah. That's actually not terrible. But then like, if there's a big encounter that you haven't seen yet, you just lose Grommash.
Yeah. So if he plays Armorsmith and then attacks and then just armors up, he should also be.
Yeah, and he has an activated for Grommash anyway.
Wow.
Like, he's got three of them.
Yeah, he's got all three ways to activate Grommash. All four of them, Deathbite. Takes it really safe. Good play here from Ikop. And now Sottl is...
Really
get a
oh,
draw!
Wow. Yeah, boom is good, but how much damage is there? There is...
Yeah, not enough.
Not enough. Not enough, but he will gain three armor.
You know what? The key here is that Whirlwind, because it can deal with minions. What a draw!
Oh my god.
Wow.
That's so good. Like, he still had a way to deal with Dr. Boom with the cards he had in the hand, but this is so much easier now.
That was a very fortuitous moment for Ikop. I don't want to hear him complaining at all, because he's been telling me he's been getting really unlucky these days.
Well, but he's not in top 16 yet, but
I mean, come on,
a very good position here.
Come on, that's just as good as it gets.
And before Booms kill Grommash.
Is it, it's
oh my god, you are
pass.
Evil.
You
are evil. Don't
look at that.
Don't
look at that.
It.
Look at that. He's that green light will go
down. That green light will go down. No, it's still green. Oh, Lothar, please.
All right.
Some people want to see the world burn.
That was
wow.
close also,
eight
but going
damage.
Dude, that would have actually been lethal if they both went
yeah.
face.
If they hit face, it would have been exact. Kini's big game hunter ripped right off the top here.
Why? He has combo to clear it anyway.
All right, here we go, here we go. Does he choose to come? Aww, okay. I really wanted him to go for the fourth
just
one.
Just Digger Hunter.
Come on.
Come on. All right.
Fine.
It's much better. And he
I know. I just wanted to.
Look at Beacom's head. He only has a slam now. And that Ancient of Lore is a great comeback card.
Well, he can't actually slam anything. He might realistically just pass.
Unless he gets a Death's Bite.
Oh my god. Now he. Now he
wow,
sort of
he has
is,
to heal.
He has to heal with Ancient of Lore.
Yeah. And drawing cards was much better at the time. But
man.
Now
what if he draws Drew the Claw, though? So then, do you heal or do you taunt?
Well, that was the second execute or the first one?
You can draw a card with Wildgrove. That was the second execute, I feel. That's
yeah.
why it was
so Wildgrowth here is actually not that good. He'll be like, well, he drew a card. And it's like, he'd rather just have that card. Because he missed the hero power now by cycling through.
I was actually thinking about hero power.
Oh, boy.
That's pretty good. You can actually get free patrons after this.
Let's slam first, though. See what we get.
I was thinking about slamming your own patron.
Yeah, exactly. Just getting
it
free patrons.
It doesn't
there,
really matter, I think.
It does matter because you will kill the Ancient of Lore anyway, and you have one more patron on board.
Yeah, and then you have actually 9 damage on board after that, so you win if there is nothing being played.
But you might get, like, Inner Rage or something.
But what would you care if you can just put additional minion on board when your opponent already uses Swipe and something like that?
Yeah, I like
this.
I guess a good point in your camp is that if he has a third patron, he sets up lethal.
Yeah, exactly. That was the biggest thing. But there's Druid of
okay,
the Claw.
Okay, Druid
of
the Claw is very good draw. But we're talking about winning the game here. And Druid is still limping to the finish line if he can get there.
Well, actually,
oh, Shade fills out the curve.
Yeah, it's perfect. Yep.
That's not bad.
Ekop is running out of threats. Like, this is the first patron, but we've seen Grommash, we've seen Dr. Bull, we've seen Shredders as well. So
it goes for the charge.
I don't know if I like this, but I think it's good.
Wait, why did he kill the...
Battle Rage.
Battle
He's
Rage.
Playing around Battle Rage. Wow! What a draw! That's so good!
Nice.
Now you can kill the 4-1 or you can copy his patron. I guess you kill the 4-1.
Outcome what? Is...
Oh, he's making
yeah,
it for weapons.
Same.
Okay. Outcome's the same either way.
Solo's shaking his head. He is visibly upset.
Because now, Force of Nature and stuff like that can't really be played.
Can he even deal with this board now?
So...
He might be just dead to Lothab.
Swipe! Okay.
Okay, wait.
Not
well, he can...
Dude, that Inner Rage...
He can clear the board.
Can he really? Like, he's so dead almost. Like
No. He attack free with Shade into free into the
four
free
Oh, yeah,
patron,
he can.
And
yeah,
then you kill everything.
That's pretty good, yeah. But then, like, you're at 2.
That's such a nail-biter. Cliffhanger with Stallone.
But, I mean, what is his deck? His deck is, like...
Wait.
All
oh,
minions.
Yeah, no.
Right? Like, yeah, by now, Sato has, like, all minions. He's used his combo, he's used his swipes. And then Nikop has what? Spells? Battle Rage.
Well, Battle Rage.
Battle Rage to a weapon.
Cycles.
One more weapon, maybe?
Fire War Axe, I think there is one more.
Oh, what a draw!
My God.
Now, Sato needs something to have taunt.
Or heal.
Or heal. Ancient of Lore would be just as good.
Scenarios!
No. Oh, Force of Nature! That's not it! He has a Force of Nature to set.
Well,
this,
he can maybe clear this with Force.
No, he's almost certainly will, unless something that's a 2-3 comes out.
Then it's still okay, he can kill it.
Oh my god! That's great!
That's awesome.
That's
I love that.
That's pretty cool.
Alright, here's another thing too.
Second Inner Rage.
Here's another thing too. Sato will hero power from this point
yes.
on. And that actually is relevant because he's going to climb out of the first weapon swing range, giving him another draw.
Well, Fireworks still kills him next turn, but after that... And now it's also awkward for Ekop because Ekop has multi spells, right?
Yeah, well, he still has another patron. Just like a straight-up Grim patron on the board.
Dreadcursor is okay.
Kind of like a Grim patron.
It's not over
but
yet.
But here's the hero power and the relevance of it.
This is so nerve-wracking for Sol. If he loses it, he's out of the tournament.
And it is...
another Shredder.
Well, but he's still not dead.
He's not dead. He's but Ekop is just one damage from killing his opponent. Any weapon or spell that buffs does it.
No, it's not.
It doesn't, but it's still an okay card. It's one damage next turn, and Sol is getting super low.
Oh, hold on. There's still what comes out of Shredder.
Vitality Totem.
Or just a taunt. Ancient of Lore! You got an Ancient of Lore up the top!
Oh!
But you kill it first with Departed Shredder, because what can you get?
Wrath. If you're gonna draw
Weblord, no, you do kill it. Like, there is nothing.
Weblord wouldn't stop.
If you get a Doomsayer,
it's not about that. Well.
Scientist is awkward. It allows the Acolyte to push into it and draw.
Yeah, but you can't do anything about it. It's so funny because Sol is such an analytical player, and his Hearts and Career right now is in the top deck war. Like, both players are laughing.
Well,
this is hilarious.
This is
guys.
Not career defining, but it certainly is hilarious. Execute.
No way.
So there was a second one.
So, I mean, good thing that the Cho died because you can't play it.
You can now execute the 5/5.
Yeah, now you can execute and give it over.
I'm almost out of cards.
Oh, weapon! But that's not enough! His last card's patron!
Yeah, the last card is patron.
And he's going to hero power.
So if he had something like Druid of the Claw.
He's going to have hero power to 8, 9. So the Grim Patron. I think the Grim Patron might be just a little bit too slow.
And actually, Solid has still 2 draws.
No, it would be just on time. He needs another Druid of the Claw. Another Druid of the Claw
on
the top!
Oh my god!
What?
That's it! That's gonna lock the game up!
Yeah, because with the Patron, Ekop can't win anymore.
Unless there's some magical Deathwing off the top of the deck.
This is so incredible. How did he even win this game?
Wow!
Ekop is saying well played. The Patron is not gonna do it.
He needed precisely those cards.
In that order for 5 turns.
Well, I mean, you got the Shredder before everything else. He could have used everything, so it's not in that order. But
this
that
was amazing. This was
what
so
a
amazing.
Crazy
this
finish.
Game, guys.
But now it's Paladin versus Druid.
Oh, that's another tough matchup for
Druid. So it's like, I'm so good at this game.
Wow, Ekop, he's probably furious.
Ekop is,
from everything from the Boombot's doing 8 maximum damage to the face.
Both times, right?
And Ekop playing around combo when he knows Subtle has the opportunity to kill him.
Those bombs did 8 damage to face to Subtle, and then back to minions, 4 damage to
Ekop. That's 1 to 64 outcome.
I will fight with honor.
Well,
that game was fully 1 of 64.
That's Hearthstone!
Wait, 1 to 128, actually.
All right, well, you guys can debate that. We're going to go on to Paladin versus Druid here. We've got the curve that could potentially just ruin the Druid.
Yeah, and it's a good... basically, it's a good matchup for Ekop as a Paladin. And that Repentance is also a great card versus Druid. It's kind of like Execute. When you play it in... Or like Freezing Trap or even Mirror Entity. Basically, when you play it on the correct spot...
I think the best comparison is usually like a preemptive...
What have the damage to me? Well, you play it on like turn 6. And
deal 100 damage and give 1 life to your opponent's minion. I don't know. I mean, Repentance is one of these really weird, awkward, and probably pretty bad card, but in certain circumstances, it's really nuts.
It's pretty hard to play around it, though.
Like, imagine if Repentance was in that last top deck war and you just put the Druid of the Claw to 1 health. Then the game becomes brand new.
Yeah, he kills it with the weapon and then Patron's alive. Well,
that
it looks
was nutty.
Really good. Really good for Ekop, though.
That is so important for him to have a Darnassus Ashman that stays alive, though. I can't begin to emphasize that the fact that he can swipe and keep this alive is so huge. Or Keeper! That's so big!
Oh, wow.
Oh my god!
Yeah,
Keeper is a
dude. Sottle might just be able to run away with this game if he can just drop Druid the Claw on curve here. And Ekop might not really have a choice because he's going to probably play a Shredder.
Yeah, he still can't kill the Aspirant, which means like Druid of the Claw is in play. And that curve, like, he basically protects Aspirant with the taunt, and then he has Thorizon into Boom.
Yeah. I mean, you said that it maybe look good for Ekop with the curve, but that Darnassus Aspirant unanswered is exactly what you want. Not because it just gives you the Mana Crystal, but now you have another body that's just poking away, help trading, doing damage.
There is one more card extremely as well. Relevant. That Bigim Hunter is actually going to answer the Mistress Challenger, because it seems like Solul will be ahead. He will be the one killing the minions. So when you play a Vanilla Mistress Challenger on board on turn 6, it's going to end up as a like 8 attack minion after Avenge. And you can just kill with Bigim Hunter.
Yeah, usually after you buff it, it becomes a 9-8, but then it becomes a 10-9 after the Competitive Spirit. So that's well within Big Game Hunter range. Sometimes you can even just pause, like, and not attack with the mysterious, or not attack into the secrets, and mysterious challenge becomes a 7-7, and you BGH it afterwards, because you don't want to activate more power on the board. So, you know, having it to answer is great, but he might not even need it. Like, realistically, he has a lot of initiative on the board here, and without, like, a consecration to really seize it back and wipe the board on Ecop's side, he's just going to have to fight more honestly with minions. And this is a case where Druid is just going to be at its strongest, because anytime he picks Savage Roar up, he's going to have so many minions that he threatens to end the game.
I think even more important will be the Swipe, because the Swipe is a ultimate weapon to secure board control for Druid, and there still was no massive battle being played. And even so, the Swipe will be very important after the Mistress Challenger will be played.
I mean, Savage Roar is almost game-ending damage already.
Oh, that cock. Coghammer can actually be pretty good here.
Coghammer is pretty good, but it doesn't even answer the Emperor.
But it helps the push.
Yeah, it helps the push a bit, and you will have a Mind Shield. And you can kill... Well, you actually kill the 2-1.
Yeah, but Doc, I mean, the damage is done. Dr. Boom is 6 mana. Now you play Boom, and Emperor's Person survives yet again.
Okay, that's also interesting. No, you don't play that. I mean, you have to keep the Swipe after your opponent, after the Paladin plays, like, overextends on the board, because that will be a point when the Paladin does overextend.
Also because, like, as we say, again, Swipe will be a 6-mana combo after that. So,
yep, agreed. Well, that's a pretty good drop out of the Pilot Shredder, though.
Yeah, it is.
You can get double jugglers there, but the bombs can actually kill the jugglers.
Alright, there's nothing to do.
And you want Mistress Challenger anyway, right?
But the Big Game Hunter in hand is just insane against this Mistress Challenger, because if I'm not mistaken,
it depends. Sotul
can't set up a Avenge on the Mysterious Challenger next turn.
Yeah. That's like what I said when the Big Game Hunter came there.
He might just kill him.
Oh yeah, that's also a good point.
He might just have enough damage to just like, well, GG, and I would be the one moving on. It depends a lot on how this ends up going for Ecop.
Well, it's highly possible that he actually kills the bombs here. Who am
I? Yeah, I think he wants the Mysterious Challenger to potentially absorb stuff. Oh, wow. Wait, hold on. Another one lands on the Boomba. And that
Juggler survives.
Hits the face for one. That's pretty good.
But now he has to attack with the Juggler, right? Like, he can still attack with a weapon, but you don't want to take 5 damage, especially because Dr. Wolf is staying on board. But then there is that Noble Sacrifice as well.
No, I think you just don't want him to potentially use that very effectively, because he can Hero Power, and say the Noble Sacrifice absorbs it, he used that 5-1 to attack into the Mysterious Challenger and then get a perfect swipe.
Mm-hmm. So now you can swipe first, face, set up Thickem Hunter for the Avenge.
Then attack with the... Can you still like Hero Power after that? You can, because you
have your Redemption. Kill the Redemption minion. You also have room to innervate the Drake.
The Drake is 4 mana, and you have innervate hero power.
Yes. He also could Wrath for 1 instead of hero power if he wants to cycle through his deck. Really big swing here, and Ecop will have to do something equally big.
He goes for the Wrath instead of the hero power. Because
he can innervate up to, he can innervate the Drake anyways, right?
Yes, but he looks for Pilot Shadow.
Don't innervate the Drake there, I guess. Or will he? How much mana is the Drake? 3?
4 mana.
4 mana. Okay, so it's not... Alright.
Yeah, so you want to pop the Noble Sacrifice.
I was kind of surprised by the fact that he used the Wrath. But okay, it's fine.
He doesn't want to leave a single minion on board for Blessing of Kings or anything like that.
So it seems like Ecop is forced to, what, like Juggler and Belcher?
Yeah, that's his best chance to survive. He also is susceptible to another swipe.
Keeper of the Grove.
Keeper of the Grove.
Does Force of Nature kill him? Yeah, because you can actually just attack with 2 into Belcher, Hero Power, kill the other one. Aspirant
Drake?
Does not.
But there's still Force
Drake
of Nature.
Drake for the win! No, looks like it's just another shade of Naxxramas.
Yeah, just shady shades sitting there.
But well, those are pretty threatening. I mean, you just sit there and
do
the knife
those?
Juggler. The juggler has to go really crazy. I think just.
I don't do because if there's a single concentration, you lose the whole board.
Yeah, you might play one of them, right?
You play one and cure power.
Okay. I think playing both is.
I won't mind playing the.
Okay,
Aspirant,
you're still
actually
on a force of nature draw to win the game.
Yeah, you're right with that. So that two outs, there's second swipe, so that's three outs. Druid of the Claw, so. No, Druid of the Claw is not an out because there's still the 1-2 minion. That's why we would like to use hero power to send
you instead
of
consecration, and that's a zombie child.
Here we go. So. No, oh, hold on. We have some juggles, right?
Five juggles here.
Five juggles. All right. They all have to hit the exact minions he needs. The shades, and he has to kill Boom.
That's not
what
we
want.
Oh,
second
that's absolutely
no.
Horrible. No, that's so bad.
That could be the end. I think Subtle is about to stay alive. 6-2 score.
On the back of that Druid Patron game, that
wow.
was amazing.
And he was able to do it effectively with a very strong comeback here. Good job. Subtle takes the series 3-2. Ecop immediately extends the hand in good sportsmanship. Recognizing that wasn't by any means an easy series for either of them.
He played well. Like, both of them played extremely well. And that Druid Patron was so funny to watch. But really nice lineups. And that Warlock is really interesting. The double Sea Giant, Seeker, Gormok. So I'm still not convinced how good it's a deck. But it's really cool to see it in the tournament.
It's pretty good. It got number one ranked legend.
Yeah, that should be good.
Yeah, it's at least a deck second.
Decent.
Yeah, I mean, it's probably much stronger than people take credit for, or sorry, give it credit for. Mm-hmm. But I think that the Warlock deck is an interesting pocket in last year's standing because it's better against the Druids if you anticipate a lot of, and there are. If you anticipate Control Warriors, you'd
also
see
better.
It's very good.
Yeah.
It is a little bit weaker to Hunters, which happened to line up poorly against Ekop's lineup. But that doesn't stop this man, Sato, who is the overcomer of bad matchups. What's up, man? That was a pretty crazy series.
That was insane, yeah. I do not know what happened in that Druid Warrior game. I don't know how that was winnable. I don't know what had to happen for me to win that game. But yeah, I lost count completely. I thought his last card was Boom, and I'd just lost.
Yeah.
But when if it was Patron, then obviously my brain is scrambled right now.
So you're writing a lot of Hearthstone articles. Mm-hmm. All the writing and preparation for this tournament prepared you for that one specific game?
I mean... That's not as ridiculous as it sounds. Like, the one thing that I do have to know is, like, I have to learn the meta inside out. I have to have experience with every deck because I'm writing guides for every deck. So even the decks that I'm not playing, you know, I have the experience of, like, what my opponent wants to do with their decks and stuff. So it does help, but there's no substitute for actually playing Hearthstone. You can't just write about it. You do actually have to practice every now and again.
That's absolutely
That's
true.
Nice to hear. From a player.
a lot of people are like, no, I watch Hearthstone. I'm a pro. I can spot lethal.
Rank
you can't.
26, chat. Yeah, but by the way, cool. I don't know if you actually saw the situation when Ico was playing Hunter, but he used Lotep to trade with your Imp Gang boss instead of his weapon, and he lost 2 damage because of that. Which finally...
And I was 2 damage off lethal.
He was 2 damage off lethal.
And he should have... If he played less conservative and more aggressive... Because he didn't... I mean, he quick shot to kill command. Something that you don't always expect. But in that scenario specifically, he was 2 damage short because he traded onto the board.
Right. Yeah. If he's facing down an 8-8 taunt and he knows I have an Argus in my hand, like, he has to just go for it, right?
Yeah, yeah.
He can't play longer. Yeah. I don't know.
Well, the second Sea Giant also something he wasn't probably anticipating.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Double like, that hand looks so awful for a while, though,
it
right?
Did.
I have,
yeah.
like, Gormok, Sea Giant, Sea Giant, and somehow that won. Like, okay.
Yeah. Why didn't you play Gormok earlier, though?
Hmm?
You kept Gormok in your hands, but you had an opportunity
on
to
the explosive trap turn?
No.
On the turn 5 when it
you
tapped
tap
into
nothing.
Thing? And you could have just played the Gormok for board control for a 4-4 minion.
Oh, right, yeah, okay. I mean, my hand was awful, right? I wanted other stuff in my hand because I wasn't going to get to play those Sea Giants anytime soon. So.
Yeah, one thing you can argue is because he life-tapped, he got Defender of Argus.
Right.
And that ended up being the key card to win the game.
Yeah,
so, I mean, it's always his iffy things. Plus, you know, you don't know if he's going to tap next turn. Mm-hmm. Maybe his play is developed, so it's a completely different line of play, and that's why people would be like, well, he should have just done that. And it's like, well, that's just a completely parallel universe. That just
One more question, though.
Yes.
Seeker, how good is it? How good is it?
I'm only playing one. I realized I shouldn't have just said that, but what the fuck. I'm only playing one. Like, I think like the deck is basically like the deck that 6-0 got triple rank one with a few months ago, right? It's just got Seekers shoved in it now.
Yeah.
And I don't think the Seekers matter that much. I think that deck's still just really damn good. So I'm just playing one Seeker because I don't like drawing one mana 1/1. So it's not.
So 6-0 was the inspiration of your deck?
Yeah, sure. If that'll help us troll Reynard, then sure. 6-0 was the inspiration for that deck.
Wow.
I approve. All right, well, congratulations, Subtle. Any final words? You're 6-2. I mean, you're only one round away from going to the top 16. Assuming your tiebreaker is good enough, but most people will be.
Yeah, I think most 7-2s are going through, right?
Cool.
I don't know. But yeah, just shout out to Complexity, shout out to Icy Veins, all my sponsors and stuff, and hopefully I can win one more.
All right, well, good luck, man. Your job's not done. In the meantime, guys, we're going to take a break, and when we come back, we're going to go with round 9, the final, to the opening of the Swiss here at the DreamHack Grand Prix. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.